But let's move on to our special focus tonight. Moving on to this, and our special guest this evening, Congress MP Shashi Tharoor and the president of the Observer Research Foundation, Samir Saran, who are both here to talk about their new book in which they have described the chaos or the disorder that the world is currently in. It's called The New World Disorder and the Indian Imperative, basically talking about where India is placed in the new global order, where the international liberal order, as they have argued, is facing a moment of crisis, and strong leaders are exploiting the grievances of citizens, real or imagined, to champion local interests instead. The authors argue that at this time, India has a major role to play, and importantly, that India's sustained commitment to constitutional democracy is a key factor to scripting this new international order. Shashi Tharoor has just raced in so he can have a glass of water first. Thanks for joining us. Samir Saran, the president of the ORF, with us as well. Thank you very much to both of you for coming in. Let me take this to you straight away, Shashi Tharoor, about what the premise of the book is. And you do say right in the beginning, you've actually listed out the things that have happened in the world. Donald Trump's election, Brexit, China hosting the Belt and Road Forum, and Xi Jinping's sort of complete grab of power there. The protests that France is facing, and of course the rise of the far right in Europe. Tell us more.
Well, about what this new world order means. I point out that if you look at the world since 1945, the big transition was the end of the Second World War and the creation of what has been known as the liberal international order. And in the process, a number of good things undoubtedly happened. There wasn't a Third World War. You didn't have major global geopolitical calamities as we had in the first half of the century, from the Holocaust to Hiroshima. You actually had developing countries being free of the colonial yoke. You had progress. And as he sometimes pulls my leg, I did spend a lot of time in my life defending that order at the United Nations. But what has happened since then is that some of the biggest votaries of that order have now turned against its premises and the way it went forward. Globalization, for example, the Americans were the biggest salesmen of globalization for years. Now we have Mr. Trump, who's turning more protectionist, who's actually engaging in trade wars, big ones with China, small ones with us and with others. You've got a situation in which undoubtedly there wasn't a Third World War, but conflicts were certainly continuing in the peripheries. Many countries have gone through troubles. And right now, if you're living in Syria or Iran or parts of Iraq, you're not going to be particularly celebrating some great post-war peace in the country. So in these circumstances, a number of issues have evolved which have become sort of acid tests for how governance has worked. We look at development debate, we look at climate change debate, we look at cyberspace and how the internet has or has not been managed in terms of global governance. We, of course, look at peace and security. And at the end of it, we basically say it's time for a paradigm shift. You need to actually rethink the assumptions. A lot of the big powers in those days are still not willing to make room for the powers that have risen since then.
Interesting that. So Samir Saran, is this new world order in a sense exactly what Shashi Tharoor is not? This whole thing of rising against the elites, the rise of strong men, strong leaders, and we're seeing that in our own country and everywhere else.
I think we sometimes confuse the rise of the popular leader or the populist leader, whichever way you want to define it, depends on your political color. We confuse that phenomenon with the larger trend that we try to examine in this book. I think Donald Trump is not the problem. I think the problem is what gave rise to Donald Trump. And this book explores the factors that created the ripe moment for someone like Trump to say globalization is bad, exclusive economics is good, migration is bad, borders need to be rigid, climate change doesn't exist, science is fables is truism. And all of this was possible because 70 years of the defense of Shashi Tharoor's world created this moment. But before I go further, let me just tell you, I think this is Shashi's most remarkable work. Shashi has been too caught up with being Hindu and being, the Hindu way, and in his domestic politics, he's too consumed by that. He's a
Vasudeva Kutumbakam, my friend. So correct. We have to think in
so master craftsman when it comes to global governance. Thank God he's turned his focus to this. But let me just quickly come back to your point, Nidhi. I think we are seeing one reality play out, sometimes violently, sometimes loudly. Elite consensus that managed the world has now been confronted with street consensus, which is actually not that consensual. So you are trying to see, you are seeing the movement from elite to the street, and we have not yet agreed to even the vocabulary and grammar and language in which these two different groups are talking to each other.
But you know what is interesting in your book is that you have both said how, you know, India must therefore take a lead in this new world order.
There is a role. I want to come to the India point up front before Shashi grabs the
No, because you've also said right there in your introduction,
our syncretic culture,
India is not insulated from the disruptions underway around the world. And we can see that, right?
Absolutely.
So how does therefore India position itself?
Actually, in some ways, both of us argue, and Shashi has spoken about this much earlier in his many earlier works about Kerala being home to the one of the oldest synagogues, oldest mosques, oldest temples and churches. But our syncretic culture and our pluralism is not guaranteed by our constitution alone. It is guaranteed by lived experience of thousands of years. And what we are trying to do in this book is look beyond the silly season, which is upon much of the world today, and look at a longer trend line and say that what has preserved and helped India retain its pluralism is going to allow India to move ahead with that plural ethic and ethos. And despite the fact that we see noise and turbulence, we are optimistic about India's role in the world order that will emerge post this period. Now, it may last 5 years or 10 years or 15 years.
But therefore, it's key what you said about India's pluralistic values. You've argued in the book that the fact that India is a constitutional democracy is perhaps our biggest strength, you know, in this new disruptive world. But that itself today is being questioned by the global community, whether it is what has happened in Kashmir or over the Citizenship Act. So how do you see that?
So that's precisely my worry. Obviously, I don't associate Samir with that, and all this has happened since we wrote the book. But the pluralism at home, to my mind, is the enabler of a role to defend pluralism abroad. I don't think an intolerant, bigoted, narrow-minded, and less democratic India can play the kind of role that we have described in the book. But an India that embodies the values of our democracy, our founding, our constitution, that is an example to the world of managing astonishing differences within the democratic space and giving everyone place in it, would be an India that could play such a role. And we are suggesting, look, India's got the technology, the human resources, the expertise to actually play a decisive role on the world stage on everything from cyberspace to outer space. We have that capacity. We've been a bit reluctant to come forward. In fact, in my book that Samir was alluding to without naming it 8 years ago, Pax Indica, I actually studied Indian foreign policy and
was
came
that
to
eight
the.
Years ago?
It was time
because
has
we
moved.
Discussed that too.
We discussed that too. And since then,
he's coming back to his core area.
So
after
I came to the conclusion that India should play a bigger role in the world. I didn't persuade my own government to do so. And now we have a different government, which seemed more ready in terms of rhetoric to step up to the plate and play a more active role. And now Samir and I are approaching the same conclusion from the different perspective of looking at the globe first. So if you like, I look at Indian foreign policy and said India should play a different role. Samir and I look at the world as a whole. How has the world been run for 70 years? Where India has largely been a rule taker and not a rule maker. And we've said it's time for us to do more. The other thing is that, you know, we have to be taking into account the resistance of those who are at the high table. And I always joke that if you're not at the table in global geopolitics, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu.
Let's talk about that.
And
the
we shouldn't be on the menu. We've been eating for lunch long enough.
How do you see the way our internal strife and our internal actions are impacting our own image and what that does to our so-called global role?
So, you know, let me paraphrase people who actually have spoken about this big Indian foreign policy challenge. And, you know, I think someone who's wiser clearly mentioned in a public forum that India is having very similar debates that the world is having today. Immigrants and migration, strong borders or porous borders, naturalization, citizenship issues, etc. Europe, US, East Asia, Southeast Asia, India. Everyone seems to be having these similar debates. Now, this is not something peculiar to India. I think this is peculiar to our moment. And we need to recognize that. Now, why is this happening? I can give you three figures that should wake us up. First, you know, if you were to look at the top 20% household by income and the bottom 20% households by income, you see a 30 to 40 year differential in life expectancy. So if you are in the bottom 20%, and this is Thomas Pogge's paper some years ago, and he mentions that if you are in the bottom 20% households today, you are going to have a right to life which is dramatically reduced. So that's one way of judging how is the world ordered itself. elite versus the street. I think that's one point. The second, look at the concentration of wealth and influence. The families versus the countries. You know, you can literally count 10, 15, 20 global families who are controlling more wealth than the bottom 50 to 60% of the entire population. So liberal economics was not that liberal and was clearly not that democratic either. So the idea that somehow our constitutions, which were liberal, created a liberal and democratic global order was based on an illusion that we fed to the people. Now, people have rebelled against that. And we are not yet willing to believe that we were not that liberal. I luckily don't have to fight for a constituency, so I don't have to take a political side. But we are faced with a rigid right and a illiberal liberal left. So, you know, we are faced with two rigid bodies who are not even willing to create. And this is not an Indian phenomenon. This is a global moment.
Yeah.
And our book looks beyond this global moment. There is going to be turbulence. There is going to be sometimes, dramatically, unstable consequences. Instability is going to be...
The question, though, is that is going to continue, isn't it, Shashi Tharoor? I mean, everyone's saying, frankly, Trump could come back in 2020.
Yes, although, again, as Samir said, let's not make it all about one individual. He could, and maybe he could be defeated, but it won't necessarily change some of these factors. In fact, there's a larger struggle going on.
I mean, I worry if Bernie Sanders comes. So, I mean, let's be very clear. Who are you choosing here now? Where is that centrist?
Bernie Sanders and you have...
Yeah, where is the centrist left or the centrist right anymore?
So, there is a certain absence of centrism. But the worry about this is that, the way in which the world has been set up, we had a system that by and large managed things effectively. It wasn't perfect, but things were being managed. Except that in the end, as the other countries rose up and said, hey, we want to play a role in this, in managing all of this, they were kept out. So as we point out in the book, in a number of these crucial areas we describe in some detail, they were losers, and by and large, we were the losers.
I mean, look at SDGs, right? Development agenda. That was supposed to be the altruistic global work, that we will help countries do better. How did you help countries do better? When you created a differential of life.
What do you think, for instance, of the democracy index? Okay, Shashi Tharoor, the fact that we have slipped by 10 places on that. Again, it fits into everything else that's happening around us at the moment. So how does that sort of augur for India's role?
Right now, as I said earlier, and I want to carefully dissociate Samir from this, I feel that we are indeed slipping on not just the democracy index, it's also the freedom of the press index. Yeah. There are a number of indexes, including, sadly, those relating to some of our human development indicators, which used to be better. We are slipping back, and the world is noticing. So while the government celebrates the progress in the ease of doing business index, which really applies only to two cities, Mumbai and Delhi, there are other indexes in which we're going down. See, I do believe that India needs to uphold the principles of its founding moment. It's something that I've been thinking about for some time. There may be a book in it for future. But we actually had a wonderful set of ideals which in many ways were an example for the world. We never went around tom-tomming about our democracy and trying to sell it to others. But others came to us in admiration because they felt that if we could do it, they in their own countries would be able to learn from us. Today, no one wants to learn from the kind of divisive, discriminatory and bigoted politics that's been given free rein by those who are in power today. And that to me is troubling. I mean, I don't think that a politics of this nature will sell well outside. In fact, I've written about how much damage it has done to our international image already. But at the same time, as Samir and I have been careful to take the long view, if you look at India as India, and not necessarily BJP rule India or the India of 2020, but an India which has certain fundamentals to its constitutional existence and to the nature of its civilization,
then you... But aren't those fundamentals being challenged today, Samir? Are they not?
They are being loudly debated. And I have no doubt in my mind that we will arrive at a conclusion which is very similar to what we arrived at in 1947 or 1951.
Which is to uphold those fundamentals.
Except the difference was that there was a small cabal of people who decided that this is the format for the country to follow. And the largest voice was not participating in those debates. Today, those voices are participating. I'm not saying the conclusion is going to be any different. But you are for the first time seeing the largest number of people participate in your political project. those people were kept out of the political conversations when India's political format was being decided by the elite. And that's why I keep coming back to the elite versus the street. Today, streets are participating in their political project. And again, I am of the view that our democracy and our pluralism is not a gift of our constitution. In fact, our constitution captured India's
core inherent character.
And therefore, I have no doubt in my mind that if you take the medium-term view of India, you will perhaps arrive at very similar conclusions. You will arrive at very similar arrangements. You will have a very different grammar, vocabulary, and perhaps also the English accent will be different. But once you change all of this, I still think that you may have different actors on the table, but I think the direction would be very similar. And let me again paraphrase someone who I don't want to cite here, but all of you would remember him saying this, that yes, it will be liberal, but it may not be Western liberalism. And we need to really think about that big difference that might happen. What does Eastern liberalism mean? And we need to start thinking about the impact of feudalism and our own strong identity and culture.
So our own version of liberalism.
So that is A. Is that going to be dramatically different or moderately different? I think that's a question we need to answer. And second, I think India's offering as a liberal state, is it going to be evangelical? Like Shashi said, we have been loath to be evangelical. Are we going to, someone said, that when the Chinese money flows across borders, the CPP flows with it, right?
That's an interesting point. So, Shashi Tharoor, final question. Where does your party fit into that? I mean, if we have to create a new version of liberalism of the East.
No, my party is profoundly committed to it. And in fact, as far as we are concerned... as far as we are concerned, India, with all its flaws, was fine the way it was in terms of what it stood for and the kind of... For example, one of the debates in the Constitution was about individual rights versus community rights. The Founding Fathers specifically said we will not have reservation on the basis of religion because that assumes preset loyalties and affiliations. We don't want that. We want each individual Indian citizen to be empowered to determine his or her and the country's political destiny by constituting their own identity themselves. The empowerment of the individual was a conscious choice by the constitution makers. We remain wedded to that. We don't agree with a religious category, for example, becoming a determinant of citizenship, which is what the present government has chosen to do. For us, that's not acceptable, and that's actually against the spirit of what the freedom movement and the nationalist movement was all about. Similarly, when it comes to ideology, we don't believe in a Hindu Rashtra. We believe in a pluralist.
The fact that your leadership represents a dynasty, isn't that exactly what is against?
I think Shashi is being very charitable to his own party.
No, but he has to be.
I think he has to be, and he has to be. But I think his
party... Doesn't that go against the sort of the new order?
If you look at the
traditions... That's the traditional old elite, the Gandhi family.
No, so I mean...
Of course, that is the elite versus the
issue of the elite versus the street is one where we can considerably debate it at longer time than you have available for us.
I have 30 seconds left.
I can say that for us, democratization was something that was a gift of the constitutional arrangements that the Congress Party had put in place. We wanted to empower people. The Constituent Assembly may have been made up of elites.
To be honest.
But the idea was to give the individual the vote and let the individual be empowered. And now the increasing democratization.
Globally, we saw parties begin with that intention, and that project was corrupted,
which created
a constituency that defied and denied the elite consensus. That is what happened around the world.
It was great to have you in the studio tonight. Thank you very much for coming in to talk about the new world.
As you can see, plenty of debates will be provoked by this book, even amongst the authors.
Even amongst the authors, the new world disorder. Thank you very much to both of you. That's it on the show tonight. Good night.
Thank you.